Actually, we have finished the first three chapters, right, of digital electronics and microprocessor. So from today we are going to start the fourth chapter. Okay, so I will just share my screen. Chapter number four, fundamentals of microprocessors. Okay, so in this video, in this chapter, we are going to see the basics of the microprocessor, not the particular specific microprocessor, but what are the different concepts of microprocessor that we are going to see. Okay, so let us start. So first thing is, what is the definition of microprocessor? So actually the name itself tells about the micro and the processor. The micro means what? It is related to the speed of operation, and the processor is nothing but some sequential or combinational circuit which performs the different arithmetic logical operations. Okay, so let us see the definitions of microprocessor. The microprocessor is a programmable device that takes in numbers, performs arithmetic or logical operations on them according to the program stored in memory, and then produces other numbers as a result. So just for an example, if suppose you want to perform addition of two numbers, okay, then we have to feed those two numbers to the processor using some instruction, right? And after that, once the processor understands what is the type of operation it has to perform, according to that it performs the addition. Okay, so this is simple definition of microprocessor. Okay, now next thing is, what is mean by programmable device? So the microprocessor can perform different sets of operations on the data it receives depending on the sequence of instructions supplied in the given program. Okay, so that means suppose we want to perform addition of two numbers, then the processor has to receive the opcode or operational code. Actually the instruction has the specific 8-bit code, and according to that 8-bit code, the processor understands what type of operation it has to perform. Okay, so each and every operation has the unique code, and by using that unique code, the processor performs the operations. So that unique code along with the data is called the instruction. Okay, unique code along with the data is called the instruction. Okay, then second statement is, by changing the program, the microprocessor manipulates the data in different ways. So here, if you want to store that particular result or data, then you have to specify the address or the register where you want to actually store the result. Okay, so it is totally dependent on the program. Okay, next thing is instruction. So what is mean by instruction? So actually right now I told you that the instruction is nothing but it can be a unique code, or it can be unique code with data, or unique code with address. Okay, so that is the instruction. So let's go to the actual instruction definition. Each microprocessor is designed to execute a specific group of operations. This group of operations is called an instruction set. This instruction set defines what the microprocessor can do and cannot do. Okay, so as I told you that if you want to perform some arithmetic operation, data transfer operation, then logical operations, then each and every operation has the unique code. Okay, next thing, what does it take in? So actually the processor requires some data to process on. Okay, so we provide the data to perform some different operations like arithmetic or logical operations. So here the data that the processor manipulates comes from input devices. So what are the different input devices? We know and we have studied the computer architecture. Okay, so computer takes the data through the keyboards, mouse, some USB operated devices, right? So these are devices that bring data into the system from the outside world. These represents devices such as keyboard, mouse, switches, likewise. Okay. Now the second thing is, what is numbers? The microprocessor has a very narrow view of on life. It only understands binary numbers. So in the digital electronics part, we have seen the different number systems like binary, decimal, hexadecimal, and octal number system. So here the processor understands the binary language only. Okay, but normally we feed the instruction in terms of hexadecimal number system. Okay, so here the numbers are in terms of binary, BCD, hexadecimal, etc. Okay, there are few applications where the processor requires the data in octal number system or decimal number system. Okay, but normally the processor works on the binary only, binary or hexadecimal. Okay, so suppose if you want to perform 15 plus 15, okay, then in the calculator we feed the number 15 plus 15, but actually those numbers will be converted into hexadecimal first and then it will be given to the processors. Okay, so actually when you feed 15 plus 15, that is 15 plus 15 in the calculator, then actually the number goes into hexadecimal as 0f plus 0f. okay, so internally it will be converted. Then next point is, a binary digit is called a bit, that is binary digit. Okay, so this is the simple definition of bit. Okay, and we have seen the what is meant by bit. So bit is nothing but the single either 0 or 1. Okay, and 1-bit storage device is called a flip flop. Okay, that we have seen in the few previous videos. The microprocessor recognizes and processes a group of bits together. This group of bits is called a word. Okay, so actually there are different the definition of word is what? It is just the data size, data bus size of a processor. So for example, the number of bits in a microprocessor's word is a measure of its abilities. We have not seen the different processors and their types, but if the processor is 8-bit processor, then for that processor 8-bit is nothing but one word. If the processor's ability is 16-bit processing, that means its data bus size is 16-bit, then for that processor one word is equal to 16 bits. If the processor is having 32-bit data bus, then for that processor the one word is equal to 32 bits. Okay, the definition of word is not fixed 8-bit or 16-bit or 32-bit or 64-bit. It is dependent on the data bus size of that processor. Okay, next point is words and bytes. So here the internal number of data lines of a microprocessor is called one word, that we have seen right now. So here the internal number of data lines of the microprocessor is called one word. Okay, so as we have seen, for 8085, for 8085 microprocessor data bus size is 8 bit. For 8051 data bus size is 8 bit. Each microcontroller data bus size is 8 bit. That means for these microprocessors and microcontrollers one word is equal to 8 bits. Okay, so this is dependent on totally the data bus width of the processor. Okay, next point is, for 8086 the one word is equal to 16 bits because it is 16 bit microprocessor. Okay, that means its data bus size is 16 bit. Okay, next point, for ARM microprocessor word is equal to 32 bits. That means for ARM, the ARM microprocessor's data bus size is 32 bit wide. Okay, next. Now here, as you know that 1 byte is equal to 8 bits, okay, and 1 nibble is equal to 4 bits. Now next point is arithmetic and logic operations. So each and every microprocessor, each and every microcontroller has arithmetic and a logical unit. Okay. So what kind of arithmetic and logic operations it performs, that we will see now. So here every microprocessor has arithmetic operations such as add, subtract as part of its instruction set. Okay. So here, in addition, microprocessors have logic operations as well as such as AND, OR, XOR, shift left, shift right, rotate left, rotate right. These kind of instructions are available. Okay, but if you go for high-end microprocessors, then some processors are having two or more operations are implemented within the single instructions. Okay, so in the syllabus, we are going to see 8086 microprocessor, that is somewhat advanced microprocessor. Okay, we will not see 8085 microprocessor, but we will see only for the introduction part of 8085 microprocessor. But in syllabus, we will see 8086 in detail. Okay. Next point is, what is memory? So actually, we have seen the flip-flop part of the digital electronics. So here, one flip-flop is equal to what? It is the 1-bit memory storage device. So likewise, the memory is having address and data. So each address is having some part of data. That means 8-bit data, 16-bit data, or 32-bit data. The data size of each address is dependent on what kind of processor. So here, memory is the location where information, that means data, is kept while not in current use. Okay. So here, I would like to give you an example. So we live in our homes. Okay. So each home is having part number and house number. Okay. So here, that home number, that ward number and home number, and the people living in that home are the data. Okay. So this is just an example. Next thing is, memory is a collection of storage devices. Usually each storage device holds 1 bit. Okay, that we know very well. Also, in most kinds of memory, these storage devices are grouped into groups of 8. These 8 storage locations can only be accessed together. So one can only read or write in terms of bytes to and from memory. So here, suppose the processor wants to fetch the instruction. Now here, fetching means what? Fetching means reading the instruction from memory. Clear? So fetching means reading the memory. And writing into the memory can be performed at different times. We cannot read or write the data simultaneously within one instruction. Okay, either we can read the data or write the data into the memory. Okay, so memory is having again the address bus and the data bus. Address bus is used to access the particular address location. Okay, address means location, and the particular data will be accessed from that address provided by the processor. Okay, memory is usually measured by the number of bytes it can hold. It is measured in kilo, mega, and lately giga. A kilo in computer language is 2^10 is equal to 1024. So 1 KB is equal to 1024 bytes. Okay, 1 mega is equal to 2^10, that is 1024 kilo, and 1 giga is equal to 2^30 is equal to 1024 mega. So if you are having some difficulty that how to remember these kilo, mega, and giga, okay, then I will just show you. We know that 2^2. Okay, so just switch to the Excel file. Okay, so here in this Excel file, I will just show you. So suppose number of address lines are suppose n, okay. So the number of locations are dependent on the number of address lines. Okay. For example, suppose if you take 0 here, then what is the 2 raised to 0? 2 raised to 0 is what? 1. Okay. I will just write here the formula. Power of 2 comma 0. That means 2 raised to 0. Enter. Okay. Now suppose if I will take here 1, then what will be the 2 raised to 1? I will just copy this formula here. 2 raised to 1. Sorry. I just wrote here hard coded 0. So actually I should provide the cell number. Okay. So cell number A2 is given here. So it is 1. And then I will copy this formula here. Then it will give you 2. Now suppose if I will drag this formula. To 9, then 2 raised to 2 equal to how much? 2 raised to 2 equal to 4. Okay, I will just simply drag this formula up to the end. So here 2 raised to 2 equal to 4 locations. That means if number of address lines are 2, then number of locations will be 4. If number of address lines is equal to 3, number of locations will be 8, and so on. Okay, for number of locations equal to 9, it will become 512 locations available. Okay. Now for your simplicity, I will just write here 1, 2, because we are not interested in 0. Okay. So just let me drag it up to 10. Okay. So automatically this number of locations will be changed. Okay. Now I will just write here is equal to this cell value plus 1, so it will give you, sorry, I want 11, so 10. Okay, so it will give you 11, and I will just copy this value here. Then you can see here, as the number goes beyond 9 here, it is 1024, that is 1024 locations by using 10 address lines, right? So from this from 10 address lines, we don't say here 1024. Instead of 1024, we will say 1 kilo. Okay. And for 11, instead of calling 2048, we will see, or we will say 2k. Okay. And if suppose I will drag this formula up to the end, up to the 20 address lines, it will give you the similar figures. Instead of here 4, you say 4k. Or 2 raised to 3, if 2 raised to 3 is equal to 8, then 2 raised to 13 equal to 8k. 2 raised to 4 equal to 16, then 2 raised to 14 equal to 16k. Likewise, you have to say, okay. For suppose I will just copy this value here, okay. Then here, and let's drag it, okay. Then here, you can say, after when you reach up to 20, then instead of saying 1024k, you will say here 1 mega. Okay, here for 20 address lines. Similarly, for 30 address lines, 1 giga. Okay, so kilo means 2 raised to, or 2 raised to 10. Mega means 2 raised to 6, and giga means 2 raised to 9. Sorry, 2 raised to 30. Okay, 9 digits will be there for giga. So similarly, for 2 raised to 40, how many address lines will be there for 2 raised to 40? Yes, can anyone say? For 2 raised to 40, how many locations will be there? Yes, it's 1 tera, right? So 1 tera locations will be there for 40 address lines. Now let's go back to the PPT. Okay, so this is how we can have the number of locations using number of address lines. Next thing is, when a program is entered into a computer, okay, when the program is entered into a computer, it is stored into memory. Then as the microprocessor starts to execute the instructions, it brings the instruction from memory into instruction decoder. It is instruction decoder block one at a time. That means whenever suppose the processor reads one instruction from memory, actually the processor doesn't know what to do with this code, instruction code. So first of all, the instruction goes into instruction register. After that instruction register block, it will be passed to instruction decoder block. Okay, so decoding means what? Decoding means it will try to understand what is the type of operation. Okay, once the instruction comes into instruction decoder block, it understands what to do with the received data, input data. Okay, and according to that, it will perform arithmetic operation, logical operations, data transfer operations. Okay, next thing is memory is also used to hold the data. The microprocessor reads, that means brings in the data from memory when it needs it, and writes or stores the results into memory when it is done. Okay, so suppose you want to perform some logical operations. Suppose I want to perform XOR of two numbers, two 8-bit numbers. Then first the processor understands, when the instruction goes into instruction decoder block, it will understand that it has to perform XOR operation on these two received 8-bit data. Then it performs the XOR operation, and in the instruction only the destination is also hidden. Okay, so the destination can be either register or the memory address. Okay, so as per the instruction type, it will store the result either into register or into the memory address. Okay, third point is, for the user to see the result, the execution of the program, the results must be presented in a human readable form. The results must be presented on an output device. This can be the monitor, a paper from the printer, a simple LED, or many other forms. So consider that there is a weighing machine, okay, digital weighing machine that we always see in the shopkeeper, in the shops. Okay, suppose you want particular material, suppose you want rice of 1 kg. Okay, then can you tell me what kind of display it is there? The display is 7-segment type display is there. Okay, 6-digit 7-segment type display. Okay, then whether that display shows you in hexadecimal. If it shows you in hexadecimal, then normal people doesn't understand. Normal people will not understand what is this A, F, D, B. Okay, for the ease of understanding, or the normal people should understand how much weight the rice is weighing, then it should show in decimal format only. It will not show 3FF like this. Okay, so that's why whatever the result is produced by the processor, that result will be converted into BCD first, binary coded decimal format. After that, again those binary coded decimal numbers will be again converted into decimal number system, and those decimal digits will be displayed on the 7-segment display. Okay, so it is simple type of simple example of how the numbers will be displayed on the output devices. Okay, next thing, now introduction to microprocessor. So microprocessor is a central processing unit, or you can say the microprocessor is the brain of your whole system. Okay, microprocessor is the brain of whole system, which controls all the input devices or output devices as per the given program into the memory. Okay, so microprocessor is a central processing unit, each on a single chip, a single integrated circuit IC has all the functional components of a CPU memory, namely arithmetic logical unit, control unit, and registers. So these three units are must in all the processors. Okay, so arithmetic and logical unit is must, control unit to control how many clocks are required to finish the current operation. So few instructions are requiring more number of cycles, more number of clock cycles. Few instructions will require less number of clock cycles. So that number of clocks will be controlled by this control unit. Okay. And finally, the register part is used for the processing purpose. Okay. Suppose some operations are required two or three number of registers. So for that purpose, to speed up the operation, the processor uses the internal registers. Okay. And also the registers are used for storing the final result also. Okay. Now next thing is functional components of microprocessor. So here these are the functional components of microprocessor. Basic diagram it is. So in the input device there are inputs, some input devices are there, that is keyboard, mouse, some simple keys. Okay, so these kind of input devices are available. Then by using these input devices, the user enters the data. Okay, so those data can be decimal number systems, hexadecimal number system, BCD number systems. Okay, and the CPU is supposed to perform data on this received data using input devices. Okay, but CPU does not understand what to do with this input data. So for that purpose, we store the program into this memory. Okay, so specifically EPROM memory is used to store the program, or NVRAM, non-volatile RAM, is used to store the program. Okay, and as per the user's requirement, the data will be processed as per the instructions given into the from the memory. Okay, and the results will be generated and it will be shown on these output devices. So output devices are like monitor, LED display, 7-segment display, LCD display. Okay, so this kind of output devices are used to show the final output, okay, to the user. So this is what the functional components of microprocessor. Okay.